also introduce our distinguished guest. And my name is Claudio Lomnitz. I'm a professor here in the anthropology department. And I'm going to offer some brief remarks on his paper, and then we'll open up for discussion. For those of you who are new to the Mexican Monday series and to the Center for Mexican Studies at Columbia, which was just created in November, we have a new tradition, so-called Mexican Mondays after the San Lunes. It's kind of a perversion of the San Lunes, which is supposed to be a day when you don't show up to work because you have a hangover. We, you know, this being Anglo-America, we work on the Monday, but we do offer alcohol and libations in order to placate the god of the god of drunkenness. We have that. We will have that outside, just for the sake of respecting the Monday. So, Professor Alessandra Russo of the Department of Latin American and Iberian Cultures here at Columbia will present our guest, Alessandra.
Thank you, Claudio. So I'm very happy to present our guest today, Serge Buzanski, who will discuss it. Will discuss his last published book, *The Eagle and the Dragon: Mexican China in the 16th Century*. Appeared in French in 2012 and presently in press with Polity Press. So I say the last published book because in fact Serge is already working on two new books. So we look forward to also discussing them here soon. Serge Buzanski is Directeur d'études at the Centre National de Recherche Scientifique in France, where he teaches at the École des Études en Sciences Sociales, and is also a visiting scholar and professor at Princeton University in the program of Latin American Studies. Since his first major bestseller, La colonisation de l'imaginaire, appeared in French in 1988 and published in English not so imaginatively as The Conquest of Mexico, Serge has contributed with more than 20 crucial books to Mexican history, Brazilian history, Iberian history, early modern history, and global history. I believe that with The Eagle and the Dragon, he also has written a milestone of Chinese history, Tu cours. As much as with his previous book, What Time Is It There?, he had also written a book that could be regarded as a milestone of Ottoman history. This progressive expansion and definition of his historical laboratory from Mexico to China via many different books, just to quote some, The Mestizo Mind, The History of Mexico, and with Carmen Bernal, The History of the New World, and the Idolatrie. So this progressive expansion is, in my opinion, achieved with two key concepts. One, that of the reconnection. And I insist here, I don't know if Serge agrees, on the term reconnection instead of connection, because as he wrote in a very nice line of an article in the Annal, he sees the work of the historian similar to that of the electrician who reconnects wires that had been disconnected by different historical approaches. So I think that it's a reconnection, not only a connection, because in fact there is also a very interesting reflection on historiography. So what has in fact disconnected these wires? This methodology is particularly evident in his last three published books in the four parts of the world, where he reconnected the entirety of the Iberian Atlas during the union of the two crowns from Mexico to Peru, the Philippines, Brazil, Goa, and Naples, among other places. Another reconnection has been brilliantly proposed in What Time Is It There?, where we see Istanbul and Mexico simultaneously mirroring and echoing each other in the late 16th and 17th century. And now in The Eagle and the Dragon, where he reconnects China and Mexico's events, mainly between 1517 and 1521. The other key concept that I find compelling in Serge's work stands in fact at the opposite of the idea of reconnection, and is that of the irreducibility and antithesis of different historical situations. This is particularly evident in The Eagle and the Dragon. In spite of the reconnection of the simultaneously between the projects of conquering China by the Portuguese and conquering Mexico by the Spaniards in the late 1510s, the two Iberian projects took very opposite and antithetical paths. And I will not unveil the end of the book because Serge will tell us why these projects were antithetical. But so I see these two concepts, the reconnection and the antithesis, the irreducibility, as very important throughout the work of Serge Bouzanski. The irreducibility, I think, is a very precious tool, methodologically speaking, to keep in mind today, in contrast with the idea of a global history shaped of continuous circulation that melted the entire world into a homogeneous shopping mall, and in contrast with the simplification that often imperial history has created, Serge Bouzanski reminds us that things do not always go as we expect. Serge is very clear on this point in a passage at the end of this book that we discussed today, which I hastily translated into English, and I quote, "The opening of the world has therefore happened in a synchronic way, but antithetically. And yet, to appreciate it, we need to abandon the passé frames of a national history, of a colonial or imperial history, which constitute an obstacle to any global approach." So Serge Bouzanski's history is not a comparative history. It's a history that is at the same time connected or reconnected, global, but also irreducible, incomparable, radically opposite. And yet it is a history that through simultaneity, parallelism, and antithesis allows us to understand perhaps better even national history. To put it paradoxically, national history of Mexico, its relationship with colonial history, is not understandable without China. And perhaps Chinese history is not fully understandable without Mexico. So, with these few remarks, I reiterate the great pleasure the Center of Mexican Studies and the Hispanic Institute for Latin American and Iberian Cultures has to have Serge Bouzanski here today, and I ask you to please join me in welcoming our guest today.
Thank you, Alessandra, for this excellent introduction to my talk, and thank you, Claudio, for inviting me in this center. And for me, it's a pleasure. It's a third year sort of ritual, no, to be invited in Colombia in April. It's always in April. Sometimes April is spring, but it's more winter time than spring in this year. By 1515, the Spanish colonists in Cuba had begun to turn their thoughts towards the great mainland, reputed to lie west and south of the island. The first expedition to the Mexican coast was conducted in 1517. The third, led by Hernán Cortés, set sail in 1519. In November of that year, at the head of a small band of foot soldiers and cavalry, the Spanish adventurer entered Mexico Tenochtitlan. Here, Cortés met Moctezuma, chief of a triple alliance, or as some prefer, emperor of the Aztecs. After an exhausting but victorious war, the conquest was sealed on August 13, 1521 by the capture of the Lake City and the collapse of Mexica power. Mexico was subjected to European control, and the rest of the continent followed suit. Whether as Latin, French, Dutch, or Anglo-Saxon Americas, the New World would long remain the prey of those European countries that had conquered, colonized, and westernized it. The first sustained contact between the Portuguese and the Chinese occurred around 1511 in Malacca, home to a major colony of immigrants from the Celestial Empire. The first Portuguese appearance on the Chinese coast dates back to at least 1513 and was repeated over the next 2 years. More important, in June 1517, an eight-ship Portuguese embassy left Malacca for Canton, where the envoys stayed until January 1520, when they set out for Beijing. This was the first diplomatic mission dispatched by European power to the Ming Empire. In May 1520, the Portuguese envoys entered Nanjing, where Ambassador Tomé Pires was received by the Shengte Emperor. Means that the Portuguese were received by the Chinese Emperor like 8 months after Cortés had been received by Moctezuma. By the end of the year, they were at the imperial court in Beijing, but the Portuguese mission was aborted, and its members were thrown into jail. The Chinese authorities did not merely slam the door in the faces of intruders, they also physically eliminated them. From then on, China consistently stood up to Europe until the mid-19th century. Now that it was invulnerable to foreign invasions, Manchurian, Japanese or Western, but in contrast to the Americas, to India and to the rest of Asia, it never allowed itself to be colonized. So why not draw together these parallel stories in which were written the divergent destinies of two vast portions of the globe, Amerindia and China? After all, there is more to this than mere parallelism or simple chronological coincidence. If the arrival of the Iberians on Mexican and Chinese coast was by no means a concerted operation, its synchrony was not fortuitous either. A common dynamic drove the two evils. During the 16th century, several parts of the world came into contact with Europeans, triggering processes that can only be grasped on a global scale. In retrospect, this began to look irreversible, marking the onset of a global unification that tends to be ascribed quite anachronistically to the late 20th century. Spatially far-flung, but temporally concurrent, at once symmetrical and complementary, this movement seems to have escaped the attention of generations of historians trapped by linguistic, historiographic, geographic boundaries inherited from the 19th century, but strangely enduring in contemporary European academia. Yet it suffices to set these histories side by side to illuminate world tracts of that intercontinental landscape that came into being in the 16th century with the emergence of two new European powers, Castile and Portugal, whose meteoric progress across the ocean threw them into contact with worlds of which they knew little or nothing. The shocks and collision that promptly resulted between Spain and Mexico or Portugal and China resulted very often lethal. Some see them as deriving from a deliberate ambition to dominate the planet by a Western imperialist logic that drove the Iberians to encircle the Earth, for to them the world, I'm quoting, had no end or limit. But this interpretation overlooks the fact that it takes two to make an encounter. The modality of the meeting, the intensity of the clashes, and the repercussions varied according to the locations and partner involved. The jolt was not the same in Mexico as it was in China. Even if both evils put people and forces into play, but nothing had prepared for such a confrontation. An even more direct thread connected these parallel stories and caused Castilian concerns to overlap with those of the Portuguese. The Spice Islands in Southeast Asia, comprised of the Banda Islands and the Moluccan archipelago. At that time, Banda was then the sole source of nutmeg and mace, and on Ternate and Tidore grew cloves. Prized by the Chinese as much as by the Europeans, these spices were traded worldwide for immense profits and set trading chains in motion from Southeast Asia to the Mediterranean of Alexandria and Venice. Confident of being navally strong enough to seize the Spice Islands and at a stroke to cut out the countless middlemen involved in this lucrative business, the Portuguese and the Castilians embarked on a race that pinched the world, the first sailing east and the second west. In 1493, the Treaty of Tordesillas had apportioned the world into two equal halves, one each for Spain and Portugal. The line that divided the Atlantic vertically from top to bottom was fairly easy to identify. But the line that divided the other side of the Earth, the anti-meridian, was as imprecise as it was virtual. Would the archipelago, the Moluccas, belong by rights to the Portuguese, or would it fall into the half allotted to Castile? The two camps found themselves in confrontation, initially by diplomatic means, later by proxy of navigators, sailors, and soldiers. Although the frontier's location remained uncertain, beyond the fact that it was on the other side of the world. At stake was the control of spices, so abundantly produced by the Banda and Maluku Islands, and also, let's not forget, for Portugal and for Spain, at stake was access to the mainland of China, the land of the Chins, Columbus Cafe, via the wealthy port of Zaitung, Changhua. The fault of ancient Mexico and the subsequent disarray of indigenous society are so taken for granted today that one tends to forget that the first skirmishes had not gone the Spaniards' way. Hernán Cortés, with barely 500 men and a score of horses plus 100 seamen, was pitted against an indigenous population verging on 20 million. Fewer, no doubt, than the 150 million Chinese under the Ming, but nonetheless a lot. In one of those global comparisons at which he was so adept, Pierre Chauny worked out that l'Amérique moyenne weighed demographically the same as North China, while the integral America of the High Plateau, with its Andean and Mesoamerican empires, was equivalent to a whole China. This yawning difference alone accounts for the excessiveness of the two European enterprises, the overriding characteristic of one of the most spectacular and dramatic instances ever of a collision between worlds. A collision that ended in the outright victory of the Europeans on Mexican soil. Western memory dwells primarily on the brutality of this early clash of civilization. This widespread version, the anti-Spanish black legend, highlights the cruelties of the Castilians while passing too hastily over the tenacity with which many indigenous societies resisted the conquistadors. It overstates the swiftness of the conquest, airbrushing out its halting beginnings, its improvisations and setbacks. The surrender of Mexico Tenochtitlan in August 1521 did not instantly sound the knell of a pre-Hispanic world or usher in a Spanish Mexico overnight. It took generations for the country to become Hispanized and Westernized. Not only did the settler have to face all kinds of resistances and heavy inertias, but the proliferation of racial mixtures also led to unexpected, unpredictable consequences that prevented local societies from either dying or becoming just clones of Castilian villages. Notwithstanding, the capture of the Mexican capital marked the beginning of a protracted takeover of the American continent that would for centuries anchor this part of the world in the Iberian, European, and ultimately Western camp. By that token, it was a continental event. But there is more. If one looks beyond the national or colonial framework, the conquest of Mexico now appears as a crucial stage in Iberian globalization, in that it initiated the integration of the great continental societies of America with it a Spanish empire that reached to the four corners of the earth. It is also embedded in the race towards the Asia of China and spices. No sooner had the Lake City fallen than Cortes' thought turned to the Pacific and the Moluccas. On both these counts, the conquista can be seen as a world-changing event. While much has been written about the reason for the collapse of Indian societies, Cortes' pragmatism, his peculiar brand of diplomacy, astutely playing on the division of both sides, including his own, the superiority of Spanish weaponry, and above all the early depredation of diseases from Europe. Iron vanquished copper before an evangelizing, destabilizing Christianity set about demolishing the routines of ancient idolatries in order to put new ones in their place. All these excellent reasons, which can be seen at work elsewhere in the American continent during the decades that followed. Compared to the brilliance of the Mexican conquest, brilliance between brackets, the embassy of Portuguese Tomé Pires looked pretty lame or even like a non-event. A forgotten incident in world historiography, familiar only to a small circle of specialists in the history of Portuguese Asia. Not only was the embassy a fiasco, it seemed thoroughly inconsequential in the short term. There was no penetration of China to speak. No conquest, no colonization, still less Christianization, certainly nothing that could claim to lash itself to the great ship of Iberian globalization. Are we to conclude that Western memory only preserves the record of victorious clashes like those in the Americas? It was instead by means of contraband, piracy, clandestinity, but the Portuguese managed to keep up commercial relations with the Chinese seaboard until they got their foothold in Macau. How such dissimilar outcomes to be explained, over and above the context we just outlined? What leaps to mind are the differences, of course, between men and between national images. The king's messenger, the ambassador Tomé Pires, was a merchant and a great observer of the business world. He had very little in common with Cortés, that blend of mischief maker, condottiere with a lucky star, and sophisticated politician. The Spaniards have and had a reputation of born conquistadores, whereas the Portuguese were viewed as traveling salesmen. And yet, in spite of these obvious apparent differences, there were many traits that applied to both nations. Passion for discovery and thirst for riches, the peerless masteries of the seas, the determination to overcome huge numerical inferiority, the efficient armaments, the reliance on supply bases, Cuba standing in for Malacca here, and the presence of outstanding individual soldiers, Cortés on one side, on the other side, Alfonso de Albuquerque, the conqueror of Goa, Malacca, and Hormuz, who has been compared to the great captains of antiquity and had the same stature as the conqueror of Mexico. Well, we should like to introduce here, returning to it further down, another more surprising point in common. The letters of Vieira and Calvo reveal that the Portuguese did in fact aspire to conquer and colonize a region of China, South China, precisely the area where they got themselves trapped. Had the Portuguese invasion not foundered so quickly, we might have been able to develop a comparison between the two Iberian nations and to speculate upon the respective reaction to numerical imbalance, their adaptation to the terrain, the capacity to destabilize the adversary, and the efficacy of the weapons. The Portuguese bid to get into China was, however, fairly stomped on by the Chinese. In fact, the explanation for the contrasting fates of the two expeditions must be thought in the attitude of the adversary and in the specificity of the terrain in each case. The Portuguese were already paralyzed before they were reduced to silence and finally wiped out. But it was China bureaucracy, as much as its fleet, that defeated the intruders. The Portuguese never managed to get on top of the situation provoked by the arrival, whereas it seemed that it was precisely the local contradiction of Mesoamerica that catapulted the conquistadors to victory. The Chinese traditionally kept foreigners at arm's length, whereas all American societies, and I'm thinking of writing by Lévi-Strauss, all American society cultivated the custom of hospitality. In American mythology, there's always a place for the other. In the case of the Chinese, there is no place for the other. Comparison of the two expeditions provides an opportunity for specialists of Mexico to revisit the conditions and successive incidents of the conquest. To my mind, Pires' expedition, the Portuguese expedition in China, becomes like a mirror that shows up some hitherto neglected aspect of the Spanish invasion of Mexico and vice versa. This is already saying a lot, but the exercise also enables a better understanding of the way in which the Spaniards and the Portuguese were separately and simultaneously confronted with two of the greatest civilizations in the world. Faced by situations they did not and could not have foreseen, exactly at the same time, the Iberians had to analyze the total novelty of societies utterly unlike their own. Both Spaniards and Portuguese had to collect information. They had to master linguistic and cultural differences. They had to grasp the geopolitics of Ming Dynasty China, but also the geopolitics of Mexican Altiplano. They had to decipher power networks and trade systems and come up with strategies for conquest and colonization. In short, they had there and then to deploy such a breadth of imagination an intellectual creativity that we cannot but question. The local or provincial vision of the Renaissance as a movement strictly confined to the European ambit or to the Mediterranean. The revelation of Chinese cities, Canton, Nanjing, Beijing, or Mexican cities, Cholula, Tlaxcala, Mexico Tenochtitlan. The revelation of a celestial bureaucracy and of the Mesoamerican armies. The wonder of Italian humanists at Chinese books and at the same time at Mexican codices. All these experiences unfolding simultaneously should henceforth be regarded today as crucial manifestation of the European Renaissance. But neither the American native peoples nor the Chinese sat back at mere passive spectators of the Iberian intrusion. The reaction were equally representative of what was provoked by Iberian globalization. If the Indians of the New World were for the Spaniards a bunch of barbarians, so the Chinese deplored the Portuguese as illiterates, brigands, pirates of the sea, and cannibals themselves. It's interesting to reflect on this inversion. For Chinese, the cannibals were the Portuguese. For Spaniards, cannibals were the Indians. It's interesting to reflect on this inversion and to note how the Portuguese explicitly submitted to their inferior position. They acknowledged the fact that they were considered as cannibals. It casts light on a quite different facet of European expansion. Likewise, we may note how the first modern image of China, created and conveyed by Pires, Vieira, Calvo, João de Barros, was being constructed exactly at the same time as the first image of Mexico, created by Cortés and Peter Martyr d'Anguera. And how these images are quite contrasting. On one side, an omnipotent, thrusting China. On the other side, defeated Mexico, rejected into a pre-Hispanic past. And in fact, till now, these images of a powerful and omnipotent China and of a country like Mexico reduced to its pre-Hispanic past or to exotic dimension are still alive. And I think that it's not useless to try to think about this peculiar moment exactly in the 20s when the two images began to invade the European imagination. The half-hearted bids, the half-hearted attempts by Portugal and much later by Spain in 1580 to conquer China were, as we know, third thrust through water, were a complete waste of time. While the New World was subjected to systematic colonization, while its resources ruthlessly stripped by the Iberian, its native religion supplanted by Christianity, China, at the same time, was enjoying unprecedented prosperity behind frontiers that were never hermetically sealed. Merchant classes were enriched by trade, and money was pouring in from Japan before coming from Manila and Macau. The Middle Kingdom was never indifferent to what went on beyond its border, especially on the South and East China Seas. But if China was forging links with the world, or better, if the world were forging links with China, this was happening on China's terms and at China's pace. The link-up was finally consummated at the end of the 16th century when American silver made its way to the Celestial Empire, either directly across the Pacific or via the Atlantic and then the Indian Ocean, white metal went to fill Chinese coffers. So the Europe-China relationship was not a matter of conquest. It was not a matter of conversion, still less of economic dependence. But they were connected, and they were connected by the circuits that girdled the world and linked its various parts together. Not only would Spain never attack China before she awoke on Tesque Despierte, the current formula in Philippines around 1580, but by exploiting American deposits and setting up a colonial society maintained by slave or indentured labor, Spain put a considerable amount of its resources at the service of the Middle Kingdom and should earn due recognition for it. There were clear advantages for American Spaniards swapping Potosi silver for costly Asian goods, most often illegally. Therefore, in the Andes or in Mexico, indigenous or African workers had no idea that they were breaking their backs for the benefit of Chinese merchants hoarding precious Mexican pesos as much as for their European bosses. Thus, the opening up of the world took place in a synchronous but antithetical manner. And to appreciate this fully, it is, of course, necessary once more to discard the tired structures of national, colonial, even imperial histories that stand in the way of a globally based approach. It's at the same time obvious that global history is not the same as the history of European expansion, even if it focuses on the European phase of globalization processes. A global early modern history helps to reinterpret the great discoveries by reestablishing links with European historiography, which European historiography has overlooked and refrained from commenting. A global history helps us cast off simplistic notion of otherness. It's not a problem of the Spaniards and the other. It's much more complicated. It means that we have much more complex scenarios involving at least four players: Mexica, Castilians, Chinese, Portuguese. And on the Chinese side, many kinds of Chinese people, of course. On the Indian side, many kinds of Indians. And of course, Portuguese living in Malacca, not Portuguese living in Lisbon. And Spaniards living in Cuba or Santo Domingo, and not Spaniards living in the Iberian Peninsula. So to shift from dualistic view of the past and rhetoric of otherness to a much more complicated game with at least four protagonists. Global history shows that not everyone is either winner or loser, and that those dominant over here may well be the dominated over there, on the other side of the world. I speak of a global history of the European Renaissance because one cannot write a history with no vantage point, without potentially succumbing to the generalities and meanders of world history. So to make a detour through global history and its linked sub-histories invariably takes us back to rethinking, in my case, it's something very important, European history. To resituate local and European history in perspective that lead beyond them is not only to reassess the real dimension, but also to revisit the distinctive feature of that part of the world, and to return to simple questions that might reward reflection. It was the Iberians who traveled to America. It was the Iberians who traveled to China, and not the other way around. And this feature led us to highlight a fracture that is surely as detrimental to our knowledge of the past as that fostered by a justly decried Eurocentrism. 16th century Europe was not Northern Europe. The agents of the discovery of Mexico and China were not French, were not German, were not English. They were Portuguese, Italians, and Spanish. We cannot overtrace the importance of the South in the beginning of the globalization, along with the whole weight of the Catholic 16th century for the history of Europe and the world. It is impossible to ignore the role of the Roman Catholic Church and its missions, so often occluded in favor of the English and Dutch expansion with the freight of Northern Reformation, when so much of the itch for planetary travel that seized Europeans was a spiritual, not to say mystical, order, when the advent of world consciousness was inseparable from the global projection of Christianity. It's a way also to this travel between Mexico, China, and the Iberian Peninsula to revisit notions of modernities in plural. In Les Quatre Parties du Monde, the book you refer to, The Four Parts of the World, we suggested that to insist on defining the emergence of modernity in exclusively European terms, in Italian, French, English, or Dutch terms, was singularly limiting. Multiple encounters with the great religion and civilization of the planet nurtured thousands of human experiences, which gave rise to other forms of modernity, secreted on the edges of each world by Europeans and by all those who came, willingly or otherwise, into contact with them. The study of Iberian design upon China and the New World forces us to rethink modernity in at least two ways. First, by granting its full importance to the Magellanic Revolution, which Peter Sloterdijk has described as not less determinative and ultimately more decisive than the Copernican Revolution. No global history of the Renaissance can ignore it. With and since Copernicus, the Earth circled the Sun. But after Magellan, it was European men, his ships and capital that began to circle the Earth with sights set on China or Mexico. Magellan Revolution impinged straight away on seamen, merchants, princes, bankers, chroniclers. It turned the seas and the mobility of men and capital into the engine of all circulation and all openings. There could be no globalization without Magellan Revolution. Whereas the four parts of the world could have been physically joined up and administered perfectly well by a planetary monarchy run by elites exposing traditional view of the cosmos derived from Aristotle and hence pre-Copernican. But world history cannot be reduced to the history of the Europeans. Magellan was killed in Mactan, a Philippine island, and Cortes' Pacific plans came to nothing. The spice cargoes would never take the South Seas route to Europe via America, and the Iberians twice decided against challenging China. Asia, and most conspicuously China, did not surrender to the European, and the latter were forced to learn the lesson. Here they could not flaunt themselves as in Brazil or elsewhere in the Americas as a lordly race of invincible superiority confronted by hordes of savages, good for nothing but to be conquered, slaughtered, or exploited. There would be no war against China. The Iberians felt impotent and outsmarted on every level, save that the level of salvation. Portuguese and Spaniards alike were not only reduced to repeating the unsparing insult dealt them by the Chinese, they finally turned the power that had so violently crushed them into a positive model. China's political, economic, cultural greatness fascinated them. The history of Europe's relation with China from the mid-16th century to the beginning of the 19th century would be that of an intellectual mirror in which Western elites forever looked at themselves. The situation was completely different with Mexico, a country that Europeans first filled away in the great archives of lost civilization. China and Mexico thus furnished European modernity with two essential and opposed points of reference. Aside from this, the Iberian enterprises in Asia and America illuminated and confirmed a remarkable dimension of European modernity: its excessiveness, its readiness to take on projects of monstrous scope, such as this treaty, Tordesillas, that carved the world in two parts at Tordesillas, the conquest of the New World from Florida to Patagonia, the intended conquest of China, twice decided, the continental and transcontinental colonization, the slave trade. In this project, the European invested all of the economic, political, military, spiritual might in those ventures. This brings the historians that I am into dialogue with German philosopher Peter Sloterdijk, who analyzed a lot, insisted a lot about the specular dimension of European expansionism of imperialism, excessiveness. The fact that we have just 1,000 Spaniards in Mexico in front of 20 million, and in spite of the difference, Cortes decided to conquer Mexico. The fact that the Portuguese in Canton were just 300 or 400. They knew perfectly well, because they had the Chinese book translated into Portuguese, that there were 150 million Chinese. In spite of the number, they decided to conquer, to colonize the south of China. So that's a dimension that appears quite clearly, clearly comparing the Mexican situation with the Chinese one. Another dimension that seems to me interesting, using this sort of parallel and connected history, the westward turn and the birth of the West. During the second half of the 16th century, the Pacific Ocean and its far oriental seaboard, including China, came into the sights of the Spanish Empire. The West Indies, Las Indias Occidentales, there was no talk in Spain of an American continent, were nothing but the prolongation, the outpost of the East Indies, China, India, laid out on the other side of the South Seas. But the incontrovertible vastness of the Pacific, the impossibility of subjugating China so as to colonize Asia, obliged the Castilians to fall back on the New World, detached from the rest of the Indies. Gradually, unstoppably colonized by European powers, America drifted east, forging enduring bonds with the old world. This ensemble gave rise to what became known as the West, a concept, eventually a reality, that can only be validly accounted for by global history. Indeed, the gestation of the European-American West cannot be separated from the failure in China and later in Japan. The failure blocked the westward movement inaugurated by the fleet of Columbus and then Magellan, reversing the direction and tendency of over 1,000 years. As we know, it has been known since antiquity that the earth was round and that it was a sphere. Aristotle noted that it was theoretically possible to reach India by a westward route, provided one was prepared to cross an ocean full of unknown winds and currents and had ships capable of sailing such vast distances. For the ancients, then, the West remained an inaccessible horizon, and little changed with medieval Europe. Medieval Europe kept its gaze fastened on the East. The Garden of Eden, the Holy Land, Jerusalem, the tales from antiquity, the memory of a crusade, the Mongol invasion, the threats presented by the Mamluk and Ottoman Islam, the fabled riches of India, and countless other elements conspired to make the Orient the goal of all hopes and all greedy desires and all hatreds when it came to confronting Islam. Even the Portuguese were compelled to act out of this tropism, for though the ships first headed down to the South Atlantic, they continued to give priority to the Orient and to the India of the ancients. Once past the Cape of Good Hope, it was the East that offered itself to Portuguese sailors and merchants. Well, with Columbus, followed by Cortes and Magellan, the course was set to the West. The direction of European circulation began to be reversed. Truth to tell, this mutation has little impact at first, as the discovery of the Caribbean islands hardly revolutionized the image people had of the West, watery waste scattered with few soon depopulated islands. The first circumnavigation of the globe also revealed how terribly long and dangerous the Western route was. Magellan and others lost their lives there. But another discovery addressed at the heart of this book consecrated the arrival of the West on European horizon. It was not related to great ocean voyages. As of 1517, the European realized that the Yucatan coast was inhabited by amazing societies whose way of life seemed similar to those of the old world. After the discovery of Mexico Tenochtitlan, of Peru, of the Inca Empire, the conviction took hold that they were really another world forgotten by the Bible and the ancients alike. As far away as Istanbul, contemporary observers were shaken by the unprecedented nature of this discovery. If they were Muslim, moreover, they naturally were outraged by a conquest that grabbed for the infidels, that is, for Christianity, a major portion of the human race. Around 1580, an anonymous chronicler in Istanbul at the Ottoman court urged the Sultan to make up for lost time by setting up to raise the new lands from the Christians and light the land of Islam in India, that is here. The West thus ceased to be a mere direction on the map. It ceased to be an inaccessible vanishing point and materialized into what it would long remain, a promised land for missionaries, a source of riches to be pillaged without compunction, a laboratory in which doggedly engineer the reproduction of a nation Europe, a space as welcoming to the immigrant as it was hellish for black Africans. And to some Catholics, the New Indies looked like the future of the Christian world. Providentially untouched by Islam and the Protestant schism, brimming with new humanity, the Indians, these territories, opened up for Catholicism vistas which seems to be closing off in Europe, corrupt and overshadowed by the Turkish menace at its walls. On the Protestant side, as we know, the 17th century nurtured dreams of a Puritan America and American Palestine cleansed of its savages' peoples. We need not reminding of the way the Americas became the great hope of generation of Europeans down the centuries, crossing the ocean in the search of safety and better life, which the old world denied them. In contrast to the senescence, despotism, languor, decadence of the East, the West rapidly asserted itself as the engine of modern civilization and the cradle of modernity. If we further consider the idea of Europe, as it is familiar to us today, the idea of Europe came into being in tandem with the emergence of a new world. It becomes clearer still why the destinies of these two parts of the world are inseparably entwined. For just as the America were fashioned by Europe, so Europe from the Renaissance onward enriched, constructed, and reproduced itself by means of its projection across the Atlantic through the ties it had formed with the various regions of the new continent. It was by dint of New Spain, New Granada, New England, New France that the mother countries got used to the double role of predators and civilizer. All these reasons for claiming that the change of course, brilliantly executed by Columbus, was of far greater significance than the islands and coasts he discovers, and further that it was China's resistance that defined the contours of the West and turned the Pacific Ocean into an immense frontier. Indeed, on 16th century maps, in official geographies and major missionary chronicles, Spain still adjudicated to itself not only America, minus Brazil, the Pacific, the Philippines, but also the whole coast of China beyond. To set China, in conclusion, beside Mexico from the start, is therefore the sine qua non of any global history of the 16th century. I believe that it enables us to reestablish lost horizon, to reassess the phenomena of expansion and conquest, comparing Portuguese attempt with the Spanish conquest of Mexico. It enables us to restore mental landscape to the original dimension, the birth of the image of Mexico, the birth of the image of China in the European imagination, and it allows also to surmount a series of academic barriers, notably that separating Portuguese histories from Spanish histories or Portuguese studies from Spanish studies. It's not just a sort of fashion, academic fashion, to try to connect the two worlds. It's a reality of the past. And it's the immense responsibility of the academy in Europe and the Americas to have separated these two worlds, which, of course, makes very difficult the understanding of the 16th, 17th, 18th, and even of Latin America today. This global history also It teaches us to observe the gradual evolution of globalization, which cannot be reduced to the great discoveries or to European expansion. Globalization is a game with many partners. And if on the west side, of course, Western Europe is the dominant part, conquering this part of the world, on the other side, it's completely the contrary. And sometimes for Western people, it's difficult to think both at the same time, the two halves of the world. Try to think at the same time, 50% of success, between brackets, conquest of Mexico, but also 15% of failure, the loss of China. And I think that it obliges to think in, which is not very easy, in plural histories. I mean, it's connected history, but histories which are not just one linear history, just one narrative. With the difficulty that it's for a European, it's not easy to penetrate Mexican history or to penetrate Mesoamerican histories. But if we try to respect the past, we must also visit Portuguese history, Portuguese expansion, and, which is a little easier today, you must enter in the other world, the Chinese world. But I also think that this sort of history, even if just early modern history, could be a good exercise for students or for me or for colleagues to try to understand the world today. I was reading this afternoon The Economist. It's impossible to open the eyes and to read without reading things about China. And very often it's a pity that most of the historians of the Western world, except the specialists, what we call in French the Orientalists, they have no idea about China. So that's a way, a very strange way perhaps for you to enter the Chinese history using the Mexican door. But for me, one side it was a good exercise, but it was also the opportunity of trying to learn with my students new things about another part of the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Serge. Thank you also, Alessandra. It's not only an honor for us to have Serge Huzinski present here today, I think, and I wanted to reflect a little bit about how his presence at this new Center for Mexican Studies is a bit of an auspicious start for us, because the work that Serge Huzinski has been doing these past few years places Mexico at the center, geographically at the center, of the world's first world history, which is an Iberian world history, or as he said now, an Iberian and Italian world history. And that effort is a fundamental point of departure for our centers. This is a new Mexican center's focus of inquiry and intellectual agenda. I want to reflect on that for a minute before raising a couple of questions and comments. Had this center been founded during the Cold War, it would have had Latin America and its relations to the United States as its core framing device. There's no question about that. That is the history of Mexican studies, it's the history of Latin American studies in this country. Today, though, with the multipolar reorientation of the world's economy, now centered in Asia, America, and Europe, we must search for other geohistorical framings for our object, so-called Mexico. It can no longer be dominated by the imaginary of what José Martí called Nuestra América, that is, by a network, by a framework that's dominated by reference to the United States. I mean, this Nuestra América as opposed to Vuestra América or whatever, the other America, that is, the US. And also by a frame of that same era, Martí, Zera, Rodó, I'm thinking Rodó, about who is truer to the spirit of Europe's civilization, that is, Nuestra America, Ibero-America, or Anglo-America. This this framing just simply cannot stand as the kind of geographical imaginary from which one might create a center for Mexican studies today in the 21st century. But also, our inquiry can neither be dominated by the imperatives of Mexican nationalism and its construction of the ways in which Mexico has to be thought about. I'm thinking here about the obsessive focus in Mexico, the obsessive focus on what Andrés Molina Enríquez famously called los grandes problemas nacionales, the great national problems, that is, the horizon of Mexican knowledge, academic knowledge in the 20th century, having been dominated to a large extent by a revolutionary project that gave a pride of place to the nation as the frame in which the great problems, the great research problems, were going to be justified. And this included not only the social sciences, by the way, but also the natural sciences to a very large degree. So given the nature of the current moment, a return to early modernity and to comprehending its specific forms of cosmopolitanism, of invention, and of hybridity is key. And for these topics, we have present here today a true pioneer who studied the cultural production of European and Mesoamerican contact in his early work with books that have made deep and lasting marks. The ones that I always remember most are The Colonization of the Imaginary, Man Gods of the Mexican Highlands, which is a kind of personal favorite of mine, and The War of Images, and who has since had the courage and talent to explore the connection between the Spanish and Ottoman empires, always with Mexico and the Americas as a referent, and now the relationship between Mesoamerica and China is refracted through Iberian expansion, trade, or colonization. So welcome, Serge Guzinski. I certainly see your project as foundational to the spirit in which this new center is being created, and very much hope that you see the center as your home here in New York, since you're coming here very often. So very welcome. It's truly an honor to have you. As regards to the chapter that I read, which is part of what was read here and partly somewhat different, I wanted to just open up with a couple of comments and questions, not much, because we don't have that much time collectively, and I don't want to hoard our collective time that much. So one point, one of the first points in this chapter that I read and that is present in the paper that you heard, is the incorporation that is produced by the incorporation of China into the field of vision around the history of New Spain, the history of Spain in America, the history of Mexico, is that it places Mexico at the geographic center in the 16th century, at least, rather than as a westernmost extreme in imperial geography or in Iberian imperial geography. This geographic alteration is itself a contribution of fundamental significance for our efforts toward deprovincializing Mexico, to use that phrase, which has become a kind of, you know, cri de guerre. Well, we're now deprovincializing lots of places, but certainly Mexico deserves to be deprovincialized. we know, for instance, that silver from Mexico was key to the economies of China and India, and specifically for their coinage, well into the Porfiriato. I'm not sure exactly the date when that crumbles, but I think it's like 1905. It's very late, you know, with the adoption of the gold standard, that these Asian economies were using Mexican silver basically for their coinage. And what's interesting about these things, that these little facts that I'm going to rehearse here, is that they point to the work that we have to do now that Serge Guzinski has done this, to think a little bit about the politics of forgetting the connection, because the politics of forgetting the connection, at least from the Mexican side, needs to be explained as much as the politics for forgetting in the European side needs to be explained. And perhaps Serge Brzezinski's talk today focused more on the problem of silence and forgetting from the angle of European history, thought from the Mexican history side. Here's, you know, an important piece of information. Another one, too, we know that anti-Chinese pogroms, to use the term, occurred in the course of the Mexican Revolution, that is, in the early 20th century, and that there was intense anti-Chinese sentiment being rallied by anti-immigrant and racist groups in Mexico through the 1930s. All that process, of course, tied in with the problem of immigration of Chinese workers to the United States, and the whole history of immigration to the United States affected very much the history of Chinese immigration in Mexico and in Canada. But the fact remains that you had in Mexico, I'll use the term pogrom. I think it's actually fair, as well as intensely racist anti-Chinese groups operating in the 20s and 30s. And we know that Chinese businessmen are today forging deep commercial and credit relations with informal economy vendors at the very heart of Mexico City, for instance. And yet, Mexicans have insisted on exoticizing China and the Chinese to a remarkable degree, painting them in some periods as social inferiors, sort of a kind of feel-good racism. I'm thinking here of someone who I've written some things about, Francisco Bulnes, who I'm very kind of fond of, a kind of horrendous racist, but very good writer, who had this racial theory of there are three races in the world. This is in the 1890s that he produces this book, Three Races in the World, the race of wheat, the race of corn, and the race of rice. And of course, the race of wheat was the superior one, the race of corn was the intermediate one, that this is the Americas, and the lowest one was the race of rice. And Bulnes, who had traveled actually throughout the world, had been on Mexico's first scientific expedition in 1874, had been to China and to Japan as well as to India, and so he explained, for example, the superiority of Japan versus China on the basis of fish, because these were a dietary racism that Bulnes developed, just as he explained the superiority of the Chilean race vis-a-vis the Peruvian race on the basis of fish. I don't know why he thought that the Peruvians didn't eat as much fish, but still, maybe the Highlands business. Anyhow, it's interesting that the fallback position of, let's say, the most inferior rung at the time of the Porfiriato was being occupied by China. And this has obviously to do with the humiliation of China in the 19th century, but it's still also connected to this deep anti-Chinese sentiment that was developing in Mexico, and especially in northern Mexico. Even today, some of this eschewing of China in Mexico still exists. That is, the figure of the Chinese, and especially, for example, Chinese accents and the like, are thought of as being both eminently ridiculizable, I don't know whether that is a word, easily ridiculed, and also easily patronized, even in the face of the tremendous imperial weight of China. So here we have work to do around the history of forgetting and how to explain that and how to actually devote serious critical attention to this. It seems to me that this scholarly work of the kind that we've heard now is setting the stage for what needs to be done, because it's clearly not going to be a minuscule effort to redress that silence. A second comment comes from, I've never had the fortune of being in China, but the first time I went to Japan, which about 15 years ago, my impression of Japan before going had always been truly that of the antipode. That is, to me, everything Japanese was everything the opposite, somehow. There was no place in my imaginary that was more opposite to neither, not only to Mexico, but let's say I was born in Chile, Latin America, South America. And I arrived, and when I got there and started visiting, you know, the castles and the cities, an image that assaulted me immediately was an impression of Japan and of Japanese history as a kind of counterfactual history of Mexico and of Peru, which was a completely unexpected reaction for me. And the image of the counterfactual was basically, well, I thought, well, you know, if Peru or Mexico had a slightly more developed military technology and had been able to fend off the Spaniards for a little while and then absorb some of the technology, maybe it would have been Japan. In this sense, I wouldn't mind a comment, in the sense that the method, as Alessandra explained it, is not a method based on comparative history, but rather it is a method focused on tracing connections. And yet, some of the results of this do lend themselves for questions to do with comparative history. And I wonder whether you see it that way or not. That is there a comparative history project to be developed, if not alongside, then at least posterior, after the connections, the nature of the connections are established. And then, let's see, maybe I'll end with one thing so that we have time. I wonder whether you could comment a little bit on the comparative significance of sign systems, images, storytelling, emblems, the kinds of themes that you dedicated your early work to in the study of contact between Mesoamerica and Spain, to the contact with China and Spain. There's a portion in the paper that I read that wasn't mentioned today, where some Portuguese chronicler described Chinese writing as something like the devil's writing. But you also have real strong, I think, development of Renaissance technologies, like in Matteo Ricci, for instance, where as a memoria, the use of the development of kind of Renaissance arts of memory connected to something like the challenges of reading Chinese script. So I wonder whether some of this a comparative success of China vis-a-vis Mesoamerica is something that you trace to communication technology or not. And finally, maybe a little comment on something that was not here presented today, but that I think is very significant in this work, and that is the problem of naming. One of the very interesting results of this incorporation of China into the same historical process as Mexico is that Serge shows that the problem of kind of this kind of nominative power that one associates with Europeans, who are sort of coming in and naming everything, is in fact already a much more complex sort of process, and that the politics of naming is actually highly differentiated. I think it's of a piece with what he remarked on today with regard to the critique of a very simple account of the other and a much more diversified account of the other. That seems also to be manifested in the history of naming, in this, especially, most particularly, in these early years of contact. So I wonder whether you could say something about that. And maybe I'll stop there. I don't know whether you'd like to make a brief comment or open.
Perhaps very briefly. I think that the issue of explaining the forgetting connection is a basic issue. The problem that it is a Mexican issue, I am not a Mexican. Mm-hmm. And for me, since many years, it's completely impossible to discuss with Mexican historians because of what you describe, mm-hmm. You know? They belong to another world, or I would say to another past. No? To answer to a question, the connection, comparative history, well, in fact, I would not say that I am interested in connected history or global history or comparative history. I am European, so I'm trying to think about what sort of use for me, for Europeans, what the Mexican history. So it's a very, in a way, a very pragmatic objective. I mean that it is very pretentious for European people to pretend to write the history of Latin America, of Mexico, Peru, and so on. But this history is very important for us. And for us today, I mean to think about the problem of our societies. This book was used by schools in the north of France in the what we call seconde, which is the 10th grade, with young people from 15, 16 years old. The teacher used the books. They divided two classes of more or less, there were 150 guys and children, most of them Muslims, and most of them from North African origin. The problem in history was to treat the relation between Europe and the rest of the world. So they decided, have nothing to do with this, but I think that it's a, for me it's a good example. The teachers and the inspector d'academy, the inspectors of school, decided to divide in four groups, 50 Chinese, 50 Portuguese, 50 Aztecs, and 50 Spaniards. So during all the years long, the classes studied the Spanish part, the Portuguese part, the Ming part, and the Aztec part. And after they wrote dialogues, and they play it in the theater in Roubaix, the north of France. And why? Well, it was a way for them to think about what's colonization. It's very difficult for people from North Africa to talk about or to think about or to discuss French colonization. But for them, the two situations were very useful because on one side, the bad Europeans were completely vanquished. No? The other side, the poor Indians were vanquished. No? So I am trying to extract from this Mexican history something which is global, but above all something that has something to say, not only to my colleagues. I don't care about the academy, it means 20 or 25 persons, no? In France, no? But to try to contribute to this formation of young Europeans, you know, trying to revisit the past. We cannot anymore in France teach the classic French past, you know, with the Chateau de la Loire, the Renaissance, and so on, you know, because the population is completely changed. Mexico, in this case, is very useful because it's at the same time the possibility of talking about the clash between Christianity, the Western world, and other worlds. And at the same time, at least in France, it would not be the same in Spain, there is a distance. So that's more or less the way I'm conceiving this form of history, which is not just to try to add a new chapter to after micro-history or world history. It's, I think that's much more urgent, at least in my country, to try to create a sort of European memory, but a European memory including people who are more and more numerous and who are coming from other parts of the world and coming with other religion. Funny detail, I remember, the girl was supposed to play the Malinche, was a Muslim, and she was not allowed to appear on stage without the veil. So they had to explain to the girl that the Malinche was not Muslim, that, and finally they convinced the girl that it was possible for her to play without the head covered, you know? That's the strange relation between the history I related in my book and the reality of a city in the north of France, which is quite a poor city, and the problem that we have of how not to integrate in a French memory, because there is not a French memory today for these people. They're not even a European memory, but trying to use this extraordinary material from Mexico to try to help these people to think about the world, you know? And Mexican history is exceptional in this aspect. So not only trying to reestablish connection with part of the European past, but also much more to try to use this past in a very pragmatic, immediate objective to try to make them think about the world today. I have other answers, but I don't want to repeat or to give another.
The floor is open. There's a question here.
I'm profoundly interested by this topic because I'm a historian of Spanish naval history, fortifications, the nationalities that came out of that. Many years ago, I had the opportunity to study in Coimbra during the height of the revolution that accompanied the collapse of the Portuguese Empire. And I met, among other people there, a Jesuit priest, a very old man, who just returned from a life of service in China, proselytizing whoever would be proselytized. And it was very interesting, because at one point he makes the comment that damning the Franciscan order because the Jesuits had almost achieved the conversion of the Chinese, which would have entailed accepting as part of the syncretism of Catholicism ancestor worship. And of course they refused, so it never happened. I I say this preface because it somehow makes me think you have a fascinating presentation, but to what extent is it valuable to continue to use as an episteme the concept of Europe, especially in these days? No, the gentleman over here, I don't know your name, made reference to how before the study of Mexican history would be bracketed by its relationship with the United States. Now, accordingly, it seems you're about to be re-bracketed in accord of the prominence that China has acquired in the world. But it seems to me that, looking at it from the naval perspective, that the way to approach what's happening in the Americas is not to think of Europe, but think of the Mediterranean. Not to think of the continent or continental formations, but to think of archipelagos. The archipelagos that are such an important part of the history of the Mediterranean as a melting pot of civilization in the world. Now, surely the Portuguese did not go, they went east as opposed to west, and the Spanish would have gone east had they not been the Treaty of Tordesillas that limited them. Before that, they were competing with the Portuguese in Africa. No?
We should cut because we need
more. So that's my question.
No, when I'm talking of Europe, I'm of course talking of today. What's for me, my idea was that Europe is appearing just in the 16th century, because at the same time is appearing the New World as the West, you know. So it's a process of formation. Before the 16th century, it has no meaning to speak. It's better to speak of letting Christian part of the world or something like that, you know. I think for me, the two processes are simultaneous, the making of the West and the making of Europe. So from the 16th century, in the 16th century, it's just the beginning of this making, and the characteristic, the feature of Europe is to be, for me, divided into two parts, the North and the South. And this fracture is first with Luther and with Protestantism schism, and after the Black Legion and so on. No? For me, the main feature of Europe as a concept is the opposition between North and South. But what I could answer very quickly to your interesting question.
I'm sorry to be sure, I just wanted to be sure that we got a chance for questions.
In a very sort of anecdotal way, I had the experience of lecturing like a couple of us here in Portugal a few times. And because I'd worked in Mexico so many years, it said I can speak Spanish very closely, but I don't speak Portuguese, but I can read it. And sometimes I don't understand it when they speak among themselves.
Could you speak up a little
very fast? Mm-hmm. But I was very struck in Portugal by the resistance to Spanish. I could not lecture in Spanish. They wanted me to lecture in English, or even if I wanted in Italian, but not in Spanish. And this struck me very much, you know, because it's this rift, this thing that you have. Mm-hmm. Called attention to, but it affects, I think, attitudes and historical attitudes and scholarly attitudes too. Now, in showing us how, in the 16th century, this discovery of Mexico and this movement, you know, is joined from east and from west, from east by the Portuguese and from west. Perhaps you didn't underline though enough the fact that, well, two things. On the one hand, the fact that the Portuguese movement, it has been mentioned, but in particular, I think it's very, very important. It's much earlier than the Spanish. That movement east of the Portuguese is goes back to the Middle Ages, and so it has some very, very, you know, a stronger, I think, influence on all that you have described and talked about, and perhaps should be underlined a bit more. The other thing, of course, is that there is the other movement from this Europe, which is the Europe of the Sacred Roman Empire and also the Europe, and also Islamic Europe, is the question of the Silk Road. It's the question of the link with the East that actually took place across the land, not by the sea. Mm-hmm. And the gentleman was talking about the sea. It's very important. It's Carl Schmitt's view, you know, of what happened. But also the movement across the land, across a huge continent, is also something that perhaps should be brought into the picture a little bit more than you have sketched. Of course, you were just talking about the introduction of the book, so it's not.
Very quickly to answer to your observation, just with an example,
yes.
Historia de las Indias, Las Casas. It's interesting to observe that Las Casas devoted like 13, 14 chapters to the history of Portuguese Africa in Historia de las Indias. I mean that on one side you have this divide, this gap, and the other side, people in the 16th century, Las Casas considered that to explain the Americas, to explain the situation of the Indians, to explain slavery, one has to integrate the history of South Atlantic and Portuguese Africa in the landscape. You know? So without talking about connected history and global history, Las Casas did it. The problem that even when I was younger and working on the Indians, I was looking in Las Casas for information about Mexico. So the pages are like 120 pages on Africa. I jumped, you know, of course.
So did I.
Not to spend my time with it. After I realized that for a guy like Las Casas, who was the first to write the history of this continent, this part of the world, he thought completely necessary to begin with the Portuguese and with the 15th century, of course. So consider that the Canarias is the beginning, and after Portuguese Africa, and after we have the Indies. So thinking in this case of the continuity, while for us all is fragmented or separated or divided. But the problem between Spaniards, that's another problem, problem of the Spaniards and Portuguese, that's the problem, you know. The only solution is to speak Spanish and to speak Portuguese. You know. There's no other way, even if it's not so easy.
A curiosity, where did you find the materials for your part of the global history on China?
On China? Well,
in what archives? Where were there your documents?
It was even simple. In the 90s, you know, I organized a series of meetings about passeurs culturels, middlemen, you know. Mm-hmm. One of the meetings took place in Lagos, so with Portuguese colleagues. And you know when, or you'll know when you are in this sort of meeting, you are receiving a lot of books. Very often you don't know what to do with these books, no? But other colleagues, they think that they are obliged to give you their books, their publication. So I accumulated a lot of publication, at that time translation of Chinese texts, about this first contact. No? It was in 92, 93, 94. I have no idea of what to do. No? It was something I put in my Portuguese library, thinking that perhaps some days, etc. But it's it was for tutors, you understand? Mm-hmm. And in fact, one could think that it's difficult to write this sort of history. The problem is not to find the sources. Most of these documents in Chinese are translated into French since the first half of the 20th century. The Chinese documents describing Portuguese cannibalism, extraordinary text, you know, they exist in French. And in a very good edition, that means people at that time were able not only to translate, but to offer this sort of edition where footnotes are much more important than the text, you know. So all these texts are existing on the two sides of the world, you know. They are or in French or in Portuguese, and for somebody knowing Spanish, of course, it's no problem to read this text. So there is not enough, that is a lot of information. And there is a lot of people today that change in China, Chinese people writing in Macau and publishing in Portuguese. And there is an interest for this moment now. So many archives were not accessible before. After beginning in the last decade of the last century, now are open. You know? So there is a circulation. The problem is not to get access to the archives, it's just to put them together on the same table. And after to see, you know, and so, of course, it would be much more scientific to learn Chinese and to go to the archives and so on, but I am too old for this kind of thing, definitely. And I think that sometimes the role of our role as professors or our researchers is not to be completely innovative, just perhaps to indicate that there are parts, that there are a new, there is a new landscape, mm-hmm. and there are tracks that could be followed, mm-hmm. and are very rich, you know. Particularly, the trying to look at the Spanish America through Portuguese eyes is very interesting, and there is a lot of documents, you know. And it's not a problem if Spaniards are reluctant or if Portuguese refuse to. Well, we are not Spaniards, we are not Portuguese, and we are not even Mexican, so we are free to visit these archives and to put them together according to our imagination.
Thank you so much. This has been a very interesting talk. I wonder if you could speak a little bit more about what's, for lack of a better word, for the official narrative or the mainstream narrative of this encounter in the Chinese history or historiography, or even popular history. Claudio has told us a little bit about how China might look from the Spanish American eyes, but I wonder how did Spanish America look from the Chinese eyes during the 16th century or even...
Well, we have today translated into a civilized language, European one, of course, two kind of sources. And the best guide would be Simo Tibuk today, the best Chinese specialist of these sources. On one side, the official Ming Chronicles. So we have continuous information about the arrival, about the travels of Portuguese, and after, about the destiny of these Portuguese in the Ming Chronicles of the 16th and 17th century. On the other side, traveling in China in the 16th century is very impressive because not only they publish books, but they have journals and all the small talks, what we call, I don't know exactly the term in English, gazetteers, gazettes, you know. So that's a very rich source because it's the local vision of the arrival of the Portuguese. And so combining the local vision with the Beijing vision, we can have an idea, no? From the sources, you know, it's an example of what we are learning from the Chinese sources, no? The Portuguese were pretending that they were Muslims. And they were using Muslim names, you know, because it was the only way to enter in the Celestial Empire, you know, because the Chinese, some Chinese were Muslims, and that more or less an idea what was Islam, you know. But of course, if you take the chronicle from Jean de Barouche, De Calas da Ásia, which is the official Portuguese chronicle of the discovery of Asia, there's not a word, because you know it's impossible in a Portuguese and Inquisition context to confess that for all the travel they presented themselves as Muslims. And not only that, they accepted to, if that's a problem of naming you were talking about, you know, they were receiving Muslim names, you know, because the it was the only way for them to exist in the eyes of the Chinese, you know. So that's very quickly what I can say to you.
Sure.
Just two questions. One is historiographical. Is the implications, or are the implications of this work that the darkest side of the Renaissance, for example, can only be understood if Asia is in the equation? Is that a way of summarizing where this fits in? Because the critique of the Renaissance, we've heard before, but I'm wondering historiographically if that's how the position is. And the second question is, both in the paper we read, the chapter we read, and in the talk, there's a wonderful way, you know, of nuancing geographical differences and asymmetries, even as the connections are comparative, even if the study is not set up comparatively. And my question is, it's possible to call the Portuguese and the Spaniards Iberians, which is something you can't do. You can't create that kind of holder for the Aztecs or for the Chinese. So my question is, in thinking about the distinction between the Portuguese mind and the Spanish mind, something that especially in the talk, is mentioned, and in empirical examples in the chapter are evident. Do you want to ponder if there'd be any differences if Spain was encountering China in the same period it was also encountering Mexico versus the Portuguese? Or is that why you can use the term Iberian? In fact, that distinction, while it's noted, is not really that problematic.
Well, we have in the Vieira letters, one of the two Portuguese, you know, a detailed program of colonization of China. We have no program from Cortes, no? Never had a program of colonization of Mexico. Never. Because colonization of Mexico was never programmed. It was never planned. It's another history. This program of colonization is very interesting because it looks like the Spanish one. It means the fact is to transform the Chinese emperor into a vassal of Manuel of Portugal, and to take the tribute from China to Lisbon. But what is striking, which is not to be found on the Spanish side, there is not a single word in the Portuguese program of evangelization. It means that. And that's very surprising because they are all Iberians. But for Tomé Pires, Vieira, Calvo, and Goa administration, it was completely unnecessary to transform the Chinese into Christians. While, as we all know, it was an obsession even of Hernán Cortés. So that's a way of answering your question. The first question, well, for me, the darker side of Renaissance was something important in his time, but it's always the old cowboy Indians, you know. That time, it's the Renaissance which is dark instead of the other part, you know. It's a dualistic view of the past. I think that the problem is not just to invert the situation, exaltation of Renaissance, of a dark Renaissance. I think it's much more interesting to put together all these scenarios at the same time. Historians are not supposed to judge the past. It's ridiculous. Historians are like all the citizens who must judge their times, not the past. And if we introduce this other part of the world, and today it seems very difficult to ignore China, it's much more difficult to speak of the darker side of the Renaissance. You know, it's much more complicated. I mean that. You enter in another landscape, in other worlds, where this sort of dualistic, good, bad, you know, Manichaeist view of the past is, I would say, not anymore possible. It has been useful to criticize European Eurocentrism, but the problem is not just with America and Europe. The problem is Europe, Africa, Asia, America, and in Asia with all sorts of empires and civilization. And we must respect the Iberians. They were in contact at the same times with Africa, with Asia, with the Great Mongol, with Japanese, with Chinese, with Aztecs. They were trying to negotiate or to conquer with all this civilization and all the religion at the same time. I think that it's much more exciting to think about it. Just instead of remaining in this sort of theater with, on one side, the bad Renaissance, on the other side, the poor Indians.
I have a follow-up. You mentioned now the fact that these Portuguese sources do not mention Christianization, so there is no word for, about Christianization. I found in the talk very interesting the fact that the West passes from being this inaccessible horizon, so nectus ultra, into the place of possibilities, especially for missionaries. And mm-hmm. this is related very much to your new project. So I was wondering, what about later projects of Christianization of China? Which is the discourse about Christianization of China? You mentioned Ricci. So a Christianization without conquest in that case. So how does this work in later projects?
You talk about Matteo Ricci, and we must remember, I was in a thesis in Switzerland in January, there are two Matteo Ricci. The first one, which is not so well known, was a spy working for Philip II. I mean that we have letters between Matteo Ricci, Manila, and Madrid, and Matteo Ricci was in charge of collecting information to prepare the conquest of China. But finally, the conquest was not made. Why? Because of the invincible armada. Because at the same time, Philip II was losing all the fleet, you know. So to send another fleet to China, to conquer China, was completely impossible. So till more or less 1586, 87, the idea of missions was continuously associated with the idea of war,
possible conquest,
of conquest. And a part of the missionaries wanted to prepare the conquest through this sort of Pacific intrusion. Others thought that it was impossible to convert the Chinese, that it was better to attack immediately. And that's why Manila sent, a Jesuit in Manila, very important, sent a project to Madrid and to Rome in order to prepare the conquest of China. Even if it sounds to us completely impossible. But we must remember that Spain was able to conquer the Americas. So it was just to add another part. So at the, in the, and it's another link with Mexican history, no? This missionary was usually prepared in New Spain. And New Spain was the outpost, was the first step to go to the serious thing that was the spiritual and material conquest of China. As if it's always a position in the middle of Mexico. No? And at that time, rich Spaniards in Mexico City were used to say, "Somos el corazón del mundo." Mm-hmm. We are the heart of the world. So they were conscious of the place that they were occupying. No? With this idea that, in fact, to link the country with Japan and with China was a way to take some distance with Madrid. No? It's also a way, a first affirmation of independence, of identity, not proto-national, but not in the sense of closing the country upon itself, but the sense of a country, Grandeza Americana, Valbuena, linking with itself, with Peru, with Asia, and with Africa, because of the slaves, and with Europe.
If there are no more questions, then please join
there
me.
There is one.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I didn't see
it. But it might be a very stupid question because I work on the finance subject.
There are no stupid questions.
I just had, I was very intrigued when you passed by, mentioned very quickly in the talk the sort of resistance of the Chinese bureaucracy. So I was just thinking about like pre-capitalist social formations. How, this is a totally naive question, which is could you give a sense of how the sort of articulation of capitalism occurs in China, and in that sense, is what's the proclivity towards abstraction, sort of in the expansion, right?
Well, if we are talking about this precise example, it's not a problem of capitalism, you know. When the Portuguese asked to negotiate commercial offers with the Chinese, everything was perfect. Perfect communication, no linguistic barrier. We're able to understand each other and to make a lot of profit. The problem, much more, it's this something so strange, which is bureaucracy, which was unknown in Europe at that time. You know, it's a rather funny history. When the boats, you know, these eight boats from Malacca, they arrived in front of the coast of China. They were part of the fleet, the Chinese fleet, and the Chinese fleet they arrived close to the Portuguese boats and they asked for the papers, documents. Are you allowed to visit China? Portuguese, you know, it's a strange situation. It was migration, exactly. For the Portuguese, it was completely incomprehensible, you know. Well, after they arrived in the harbor of Canton, second commission from the Chinese, are you allowed to land in this harbor and for what? Papers, documents. They have no papers, documents, of course. No. So finally, they were received in the mosque of Canton because Chinese thought that they were Muslims. You know. So they put the Portuguese in the mosque, thinking that it was a way of welcoming them, you know, and saying, we can do nothing without receiving the order from Beijing. Canton is the south of China. Beijing is the north. So they wait. They spend a year waiting for the answer from Beijing. You know? That's the way the Chinese slowly destroyed the Portuguese. You know? They went to Nanjing. Nanjing, they met the emperor, Cheng Te. Very good contact. But Nanjing was not Beijing. In Beijing, when they arrived, they tried to have an encounter to meet again the emperor. They had to follow all the bureaucratic itinerary. No? And they could never meet the emperor. No? So you asked me about the region of the defeat on the Mexican side. I think that the Aztecs were defeated by the other Indians. And mostly it's the Indians who were the conqueror of Mexico. All the allies of Tlaxcaltecan and other groups were struggling with Cortes to get rid of the Aztecs. No? In the case, and that's a completely different world, in the case of China, we are in front of this monster that we do know, everybody, you know? I spent last week to fill my tax return, you know? And I spent every day, I had another problem, you know, because of the mysteries of the federal administration, you know? And it's destroyed, you know? Well, in the case of these poor Portuguese, the Chinese were never saying no. The Chinese were not Mexican. They're not saying no, but they're saying asking for the document. And something that the Portuguese understood very quickly, that giving some money could agilizar los trámites. And when Philip II sent an embassy, when he didn't know what to do to wage war, to send an embassy, in the embassy there was a big amount of money to pay the mandarins, because they know that to get something in China, they must pay for it. Not only that, of course, there were corruption also in Spain and in Portugal at that time, but that it was finally a way of entering is this machine, you know, that in fact destroyed the first embassy, you know, to pay and to try to avoid all of these different steps with the fleet, with migration, with the administration of Canton, and there is a vice king in Canton. So all those levels supposed to have a good document in the good moment.
Thank you so much. So please join me in thanking Sergio. And you're all welcome to join us in a reception here right next door.